Michael, do you have that picture for me, please? You can just put it up. So the theme of my message this morning is seed time and harvest. Seed time and harvest. Oh, I don't know. It's a bit dark. Yeah, thank you. Can you see that? This is a picture. A few months ago, we were up in Oshakati at the church there. And at the back of the church, there's a piece of open ground. And I took a photograph there. One of the local pastors there, Pastor Samuel, he planted some maize. And every morning, he came with his bucky, and in the back he had water that he fetched at a local Oshona there in his 20-liter paint buckets. And he faithfully watered these maize plants every morning. And he said to me the one morning something very profound, and it stuck with me. And he said, "You know what? We only need to start the work, and God will join us." And that was so profound to me, you know. I thought, wow. So seed time and harvest. In Ecclesiastes 11 verse 4, the Lord says, "He who observes the wind shall not sow, and he who regards the clouds will not reap." So friends, let's not trust in the elements or in our own abilities. Let's put our trust in the Lord. Another scripture in John 4, verse 35, Jesus says, "Do not say there are 4 months and then the harvest, but lift up your eyes and look. The fields are white unto harvest, and the workers are few." So for a harvest, there needs to be a few things in place, right? First of all, we need seed. Second, there needs to be soil. Thirdly, we need servants. Then a season. The fourth one, a sacrifice. We need showers. And then the seventh one, a sure hope. Okay, seven S's. So friends, the seed is the word of God that needs to be planted into men's hearts. Then the soil. In the parable of the sower, Mark 4 verse 8, Jesus speaks about the sower sowing seed. And the good soil, when the seed falls onto the good soil, there's a harvest 30, 60, and 100 fold. And the soil is like the heart. Myself and Stefan, we were discussing this past week, soil. He had some people coming over to his house just to look at his garden, and they said, "You need to give some attention to the soil." So the soil needs to be fed with compost. It needs to be fed with nutrients so that the plants can be fed. So friends, people's hearts, we need to prepare through prayer. Prayer is so important. Another thing Annika just reminded me yesterday, you know, about the soil. The one that leads an unbeliever to Christ may be the 100th person, but the faithful Sunday teacher, the grandmother that prays, they all fertilizing the soil. All right, so don't give up, but we'll get to that one. Then, servants. When it's harvest time, we all need to be hands on deck. Everybody needs to be there during harvest time. There's no time to be idle. The season. Friends, if we don't reap in season, we might lose the harvest. We might lose the harvest. Sacrifice. I love it when Ed always shares time, talent, treasure. That's the sacrifice. But the reward is great. The reward is great. Showers, rain is needed. Friends, and in the spiritual, we need the Holy Spirit. If everything is not undergirded by the Holy Spirit, we are working in vain. And then a sure hope. 2 weeks ago, Mayring started off by saying he's got a word, and it's never give up. Don't give up. And you know, the farmer, when the seed is in the ground, He lives for that harvest. There's a sure hope of a harvest. So I want to get back to the seed. In Mark 4:31, Jesus says, the kingdom of God is like a mustard seed. And the first key to the harvest is the seed. The word of God is the seed that needs to be planted into man's heart. And friends, as you will know, there's tremendous power in seed. All the genetics of a mighty oak tree is found in the acorn, in the seed. And even a small seed, like a mustard seed, can become, or will become, a huge, big tree. And it made me think, one person coming to Christ can have such an impact on the kingdom of God, can have an impact on millions of lives. Ed Finn, the other Ed, the friend that just visited from America, Ed's friend, the previous time I had a coffee with him, you know, and he just shared with me from Timothy, and he said to me, you know, Gideon, I don't have to preach to millions of people. I only need to walk with one person. Be faithful in walking with one. Yes, some of us are called to preach for millions and thousands, but be faithful in walking with the one. It struck me. Genesis 1 verse 29. Right in the beginning. Then God said, I give you every seed bearing plant on the face of the earth, and every tree that has fruit with seed in it. They will be yours for food. So friends, God gave us this law, this principle of seed time and harvest. God expects man to sustain his life by the seed that he sows. Galatians 6 verse 7, a well-known verse, it says, do not be deceived. God cannot be mocked. A man reaps what he sows. The one who sows to please his sinful nature, from that nature will reap destruction. The one who sows to please the Spirit, from the Spirit will reap eternal life. Every seed that you sow, you are to expect a harvest from it. And friends, yes, a lot of the time this verse is read in a negative sense, but there's a positive side to it as well. All right, we'll get to that. But every seed sown by you, you can expect a harvest from it. And if you think about it, our lives are a sum total of the seed that we've been sowing. And if you're not happy with the harvest and how it looks like at this stage, maybe it's time to till the ground again and to start sowing new seed, to start planting new seed. Our thoughts, our words, our deeds, our seed. Galatians 6, verse 7, we read, do not be deceived. That do not be deceived, meaning take note, let it sink in. We can apply this verse in a positive way. If we train ourselves to think, if we train ourselves to speak and act on God's word, and then we can expect a harvest on that, a good harvest. As we said, we can sow to the flesh or to the spirit. Sowing to the spirit means thinking according to God's word, speaking God's word. It's important, friends, to get the word of God down in our hearts in abundance. Are you listening? When we have the word of God in our hearts in abundance, that is what we will speak. That is what will come out of your mouth. And friends, this is especially important in a crisis. So spend time in the word daily. Speaking God's word is like planting a seed. Mark 4:26 to 29, Jesus also said, this is what the kingdom of God is like. A man scatters seed on the ground. night and day, whether he sleeps or gets up, the seed sprouts and grows, though he does not know how. All by itself, the soil produces corn, first the stalk, then the ear, then the full grain in the ear. As soon as the grain is ripe, he puts the sickle to it, because the harvest has come. So friends, when we speak God's word, it's like that farmer putting seed in the ground. So speak healing scriptures for healing. Isaiah 53 verse 5, by his stripes we are healed. The same for the peace of God in your life. When you tend to be fretful or full of anxiety. Matthew 6, 25. Do not worry about what you will eat or drink or what you will wear. But seek first the kingdom of God, and all these other things shall be added unto you. And there are many more scriptures like this, the promises of God that we can hold on to. Finances. What does God's word say about finances? Then sow finances. Finances also seed. Every time I bless someone, every time I give unto the kingdom of God, it's like that farmer sowing seed. And we can expect a harvest from it. 2 Corinthians 9, verse 6 and 7, it reads, remember this, whoever sows sparingly will also reap sparingly. And whoever sows generously will also reap generously. Each man should give what he has decided in his heart to give, not reluctantly or under compulsion, but God loves a cheerful giver. It's an amazing chapter. You can continue reading that at home as well. God says he gives seed to the sower. Go think about that. And how God blesses us. You know, farmers have a confidence in the coming harvest when the seed is in the ground. And when the seed in the ground is good, especially then, they go to bed without worrying what's happening underneath the ground there. And speaking God's word is like sowing that seed, expecting a harvest. Friends, if you don't like the harvest you're experiencing now, let's make a plan. Make a plan. God's grace, we sang about it just now. We have God's grace. There's time to till the ground. Sow some new seed. God intended right from the beginning that man is to sustain himself by the seed that he sows. Genesis 8 verse 22, God says, as long as the earth endures, seed time and harvest, cold and heat, summer and winter, day and night, it will never cease. And the earth is still enduring, right? This is the law or the principle our lives will be sustained by. So let's apply this law in a positive way. God always honors his word. So make a decision today to become more selective about what you think. Cast out the negative thoughts. 2 Corinthians 10, verse 3 to 5, talks about strongholds. And if we don't cast out negative thoughts, you know, it's toxic. But the same chapter in verse 4, it says we can cast down strongholds. Why is it so important to cast these down? Friends, if we meditate too long on negative thoughts, what happens? It drops into our hearts. And what happens then? We start speaking them. And it produces a harvest that you don't want. Jesus says in Matthew 12, verse 34 to 40, for out of the overflow of the heart, the mouth speaks. So let's become more selective with what we allow into our minds. Verse 5 in the same chapter says, or speaks about taking every thought captive and making it obedient to Christ. Adding on to that, Philippians 4 verse 8, this is what we should do. Finally, brothers, whatever is true, whatever is noble, whatever is right, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is admirable, if anything is excellent or praiseworthy, think about such things. Whatever you've learned or received or heard from me or seen in me, put it into practice. And the God of peace will be with you. Praise God. So friends, let's do these. Let's cast down what is not of the Lord and replace it with the Word of God. Things that are true. It will come out of your mouth as a seed producing a good harvest. Learn to plant good seeds. Learn to plant the Word of God. And God will back it with a good harvest. Guy shared a story. He was still a small boy. So he would go with his grandfather with his big, massive Ferguson tractor onto the farmland, and they would till the ground. They would plow the ground. He would sit on his grandfather's lap. And then the time would come, they would put in the seed. And then his grandfather would go. He would park this tractor in the barn. And they would get off, and he would say, "My son, we're going to have a great harvest this year." And he would say, "But Grandpa, how do you know?" He said, "Because we've put in good seed in good soil." And then he said his grandfather would go to bed and he would sleep without a worry. Galatians 6 verse 9 says, "Let us not become weary in doing good, for at the proper time we will reap a harvest if we do not give up." Don't become weary, don't give up, be patient. We need to hold on if we want to reap a harvest. You know, the farmer, a day after he has put the seed in the ground and he walks out and there's no growth, he doesn't go and plow all the seeds out again. No, he waits patiently. Patience, faith, rejoicing in God as our provider. Habakkuk 3 verse 17, one of the most beautiful scriptures for me, familiar scripture. "Though the fig tree does not bud, and there are no grapes on the vines, though the olive crop fails, and the fields produce no food, though there are no sheep in the pen, and no cattle in the stalls," what does it say? "Yet I will rejoice in the Lord." Wow. "I will be joyful in God my Savior." You know, friends, it's so easy to rejoice in the Lord when everything is going well, eh? But the world outside, they wait and they want to see how we're going to react when things are not going so well. Angus Buchan, being a farmer, he shares one year how he had an absolutely disastrous planting season. So what happened is he calibrated the planting machine incorrectly. He made a mistake. So he ended up planting less than half of the maize plants that he intended to plant. And he recalled being desperate, distraught, thinking to himself, "Oh, this time I failed completely." But he says, you know, he chose to rejoice in the Lord because He is a good God. It struck me when I read that. He chose to rejoice in the Lord. Why? Because our Father is a good God. I think we sang about it this morning as well, huh? And you know what happened? That year happened to be one of the most disastrous droughts on that farm they ever experienced. But because of the larger spacing between the plants, You know, he could reap a harvest. If he had done it correctly, there would have been no harvest. But because of the spacing of the lesser plants, he could reap a harvest that paid all his debt and put food on the table for his family. Sometimes a situation might appear to be an absolute disaster, and yet it turns out to be an absolute blessing. I thought to myself, yes, he chose to rejoice in the Lord, planting seeds of worship instead of complaining. Friends, I want to end off with Joel 2, verse 1. And it says, blow the trumpet in Zion, sound the alarm on my holy hill. Let all who live in the land tremble, for the day of the Lord is coming. It is close at hand. Like never before, friends, it's time to sound the alarm. Jesus is coming. It's time to tell the inhabitants of the land that the Lord is coming. There's a sense of urgency on the earth. Don't know about you, but one can see it in nature. You see it in people's lives. People need to be prepared for the coming of the Lord. People need to know that it's time to come back to the Lord. So this morning, don't leave off for tomorrow what you can do today. Make sure today that you contact that loved one. Make sure that you mention to those you work with, people you're studying with, people that you are playing sports with, that the day of the Lord is near. John 4:35. Jesus says, do not say there are 4 months and then the harvest, but lift up your eyes and look. The fields are white unto harvest. The workers are few. So let's keep short accounts with people, and let's keep even shorter accounts with God. Don't leave anything undone. If there's an issue that needs to be resolved, let it be done while there is still time. Because the Lord is coming soon. And as God's watchmen, we have the obligation to blow the trumpet in Zion. Somebody painted a picture. He said, imagine this. A watchman, bugle in hand, on the top of the turret of a castle, fast asleep. The enemy in the multitudes coming over the hills, the valleys, towards this castle. The people inside of the castle sleeping, totally unaware, depending on this God with his bugle in hand, fast asleep. May we not be like this watchman, being fast asleep. Let's go out and plant the seed that we have received. Amen. Let's pray. So Lord Jesus, we thank you this morning for your word. Your word that is seed, Father God. Father, I pray that Holy Spirit, you will come and that this seed that you've planted inside of us, Lord, that we will go out and sow into man's lives. Lord, we want to pray, Father, for good ground for the soil to fall into as well, that we will continue praying for good ground. Lord, I thank you that you're a gracious God and that you've given us time. Help us to be faithful servants, Lord, with time, talent, and treasure, Father, to reap this harvest, to be part of this season, Lord, of harvest. We thank you, Father, for your goodness. We thank you for eternity, Lord, that we can look forward to, the ultimate reward, being with you, Lord Jesus. Father, I pray a blessing over each and every family that's represented here this morning. Those who are on holiday maybe that can't be here, or for other some other reason, Father, we bless them in Jesus' name. Thank you, Father. Thank you that you are a good God and that we can come before you with anything and everything, knowing that you are the good shepherd, that you are faithful. We love you, Lord, and we thank you for your goodness. Amen.